listen in. Thanks for doing just that. Music has some sort of magical, maybe mystical thing happening.
Mystical.
And I couldn't be more sucked in.
I love it.
You see, I want to live life better, unless I'm in some sort of funk and all I want to do is wallow. Songs, artists, musicians, lyrics, they help me.
I love it.
In all sides of life. They're like lifts in my shoes. I walk a little taller, my shoulders are on my back.
Yeah. Bring on life.
Bring it completely on.
Bring on life.
So I'm full of questions and I listen in. Luckily, or hopefully, I travel with a recorder and open SM58 microphones. You've got questions?
You've got questions.
I've got more.
Listen. Yeah.
I'm Frank Jenks. I began listening in with a syndicated radio program, interspersing conversation pieces with songs and subject matter. And now, I just want to offer this fullness, the greatness, the insight directly from rock stars to you this way. This interview starts great and ends great. In the middle, it's pretty awesome too. Peter Furler, leader man of Newsboys, could have taken Highway Predictable, yet he chose exit number 37 toward material reduction. Now I, as you will soon hear, I am captivated by this and still want to minimize after living a life of accumulation. The only pile I want to add to now is more interviews with more rock stars, more truth, more greatness. This was recorded in Muskegon, Michigan on August 8th, 2012. I am so intrigued that you decided to leave it all behind. Whatever that means, but reading about how you sold everything, moved away from the music business, you know, or at least the hub of where you were, right?
Yes.
I guess, I assume various dominoes fell over years and years and years. You said, okay, we have to do this, but what was the last domino that you went, I'm out?
I think it was the cost started to outweigh maybe the creative process. You know, the cost started to take its toll. Maybe it's kind of like ground, you know, just after a while, man, it keeps churning out this fruit and it doesn't rest, and all of a sudden the fruit doesn't have what it's meant to have, the nutrients. I don't know, you know, for me it was just the process of you know, I think I'd lost for a while just the joy of creating something out of nothing, you know, and just for nothing, except just for the pure joy of creating something out of nothing. And I think for me, and looking at, you know, being a young kid coming over from Australia and kind of getting the American dream, you know, the gold records and the and the stuff that comes with that, you know, what's the saying, you know, it's nothing worse than getting all you wanted and realize it wasn't what you wanted. So my wife and I, we were in great spirits when I decided to finish up with the Newsboys. It wasn't like a, man, guys, I'm burnt out, I got to get out of here. Yeah. You know, that's not a good time to make a decision. It was just really, you know, we'd traveled around in an RV, you know, the two of us and our dog, and I drove to all the shows just because I'm that, you know, that to me, I got to see what's on the other side all the time, you know, whether it's if I got to ride my motorbike to every show, if I got to walk, whatever it is that, you know, but this time it was an RV. And so, you know, we just lived in that small space, you know, things like conserving water. You know, rock stars don't think about that too much. You know, you're in tour buses or jets and nice hotels and stuff, you know.
Right.
Then to go to an RV and sleeping in Walmart supercenters and KOA campgrounds, it's a whole new life. But it, you know, kind of left our eyes wide open. So we got back to Nashville after doing that for close to 2 years. I drove 110,000 miles.
Wow.
And, you know, we were barely home, the two of us. Had a blast. Loved it. You know, kind of just, we weren't camping types, you know, my wife definitely wasn't a camping type and I wasn't really, you know.
Yeah.
And we're out in the woods and, you know, places and cooking whatever we could, you know, find up. And then getting back to our life in Nashville, we're like, what are we doing? You know, and that was the big, I think that was the last domino, realizing, you know, it's kind of like, you know, when people go on a missions trip, usually most of the time the thing that changes the most is them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they might go and build a house and really touch a family or do something, but it's really them that comes back. And, you know, and it could be a defining moment. I think that was what it was for us.
So did you just start throwing for sale signs on everything?
Big time, yeah. Just you know, when cars, if there was a lease up, I just handed it back. Some of them I handed it back early. Put the house up for sale. We had other stuff. I had, you know, involvement in some summer festivals and record companies. Got rid of that too. Furniture. Yep. Gave it away, auctioned it, whatever, however way I could get, called my buddies, right. Hey man, you know that couch you always liked, come right. and get it, you know.
Right, right.
So, and we just, you know, and just really, it took a while just to simplify. And so in everything we began to look at, hey, whatever you know, I think that's what probably happened in the West, is people weren't looking at stuff and going, okay, for me to get that, I not only have to do this much work and be away from my family or stress or these hours just to get that thing, and then I have to maintain it, you know. And so for us, we begin to count the cost, you know. And creatively, again, getting back to that, it was like, man, I just wanted to, you know, make music just for the love of it, enjoy of it, as opposed to keeping a big merry-go-round going.
Yeah. Did you see the movie or read the book, Into the Wild?
No, I heard about it.
Yeah, right. I mean, just sort of a guy who wanted to get away from it all. I mean, it, you know, it doesn't end great for him, right? Or at least theoretically it doesn't. But there's that thing that's still inside of me that thinks someday I just want to get in the car and I'm going to do an interview with Peter Furler and I just keep driving.
Right. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And that's a good, you know, this part of it too is I've had that type of thought, and some of the things I've chased were fantasies.
Sure.
And I just kind of lacked judgment, and I, you know, chased it and realized, hey, it's not, it isn't what it was. But I think that spirit is something you always have to keep, you know, that's in us, and it is, you know, we were, you know, I do believe strongly that, you know, every man and woman has to have, you know, some sort of, I don't know, hope, you know, and vision and something. You just have to, because we all got it. It's not for just creative types or for, I mean, we're all creative types, really. And so we've all got to, you know, we've got to have that thing that's in front of us that's really, we look forward to. And you have to seize it. I think for me, that's what I had to do. It's like, man, I just got to, you know, I got to go after this. And I'm on that trip now. I'm still on it. It doesn't end.
Right.
It's not like you're on the trip and you're like, well.
Right.
You know, oh, that was great. You know, I sold all my furniture and all this. No, I'm still, my wife and I are still in that mindset. You know, we still look at everything and we go, we don't need that. And and we're still, you know, I probably honestly, three months ago, gave some more furniture to Phil.
Yeah.
You know, we'd shrunk stuff down to a storage shed, little storage shed, and I still went through that the other day and going, oh, it's good, there's more stuff to go, you know.
So do you consider yourself now a minimalist?
I think so. I think
I don't know the exact definition of that, but I know it's
traveling light. You know, is really something. My father has always kind of had this sort of quasi prophetic gift. You know, what I mean, he's always been someone, and he's been someone that's thrown out stuff to me through the years. And I'm going, great, Dad, that's great. You know, hop on the bus, we're going. You know what I mean? And you know, he'd ride the bus with us a lot, ride the road, let's go. You know, but you know, he told me down the line, probably a few years ago, he said, I think you're going to be traveling online. I didn't know what he meant. And I actually didn't even, it wasn't in the equation when I was making the decision. It came after. I remembered it. I was like, after that. And so, it's even with my guitar rig and my pedal board, everything. Now I'm trying to do, even the band, it's like the band, we don't use any bells and whistles. There's no, it's 100% live. There's no tracks. I've gone back to a mic with a cable and, you know, I don't use in-ears. And so, yes, it is overflowing into, you know, it's like I can go into to a work. Gig and I don't care if what guitar I pick up. I'm going to play that one, or, you know, I take this real, definitely a minimalist approach. And and it's a thrill right now. And if I see it changing, I go back to it, you know.
You know what I love is the thing I asked you before we turned on the microphones. How many black shirts do you own?
Okay.
And that is the perfect answer, right? As you said, enough.
Yeah.
And that might only be two or three.
That's it, yeah.
You know, but it... that is all you need, because I think an article in like Wired magazine or whatever about, you know, literally bringing it down, if you will, to what you really wear.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
Because I think about my dad's shoes in his closet. He had work shoes, Sunday shoes, and like shoes he might play sports with me in.
Right, yeah.
I've got at least 15 or 20 pair of shoes,
that's right?
Right,
yeah.
And I can justify every pair to you right now.
Yeah.
But do I really need them?
That's right. That's it. Well, you see, these are.
Yeah.
That's it. You know, and there's my boots and that bag there. That's what I live in right now. It's not real. And that's got my guitar pedals in it when I came. So,
really?
Yeah. So I kind of, I enjoy that. It's kind of a thrill. I find more of a thrill out of that right. than collecting stuff, you know.
Well, did you, I mean, and this is a different thing too, because I think if I were single, I might go, yeah, I can do this. But you had to bring somebody along on that ride, and she had to say, okay, I'm willing.
Yes. That's huge. There's power in that. And, we're still the same today. You know, we've just sold the place that we're in, down in Florida. And we're kind of like, where do you want to go? I'm like, I don't know. What do you want to do? Well, I don't know. But we're at peace. It's not like we're, you know, and so we'll see, you know, yes, there's always temptations to do this or do that. But then we look and go, hang on, you know, let's not forget where we came from. And so it's power, and there is power in that. It's really important. And I'm very blessed that way. I've actually, my wife probably swings more that way than I do. I'm probably more the, you
interesting.
Know, I see a guitar and I'm like, I've got to get out of the store.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So, yeah. And, but yes, it is a blessing to have that. And, you know, so I'm very happy about that. It's like it's something we do together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like, you know, if couples have some sort of hobby or, you know, interest together, that's definitely one for us, is just living a simple life and you know, not trying to keep up with the Joneses in anything, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, even in my music, it's like I just love making music. I'm having the greatest time of just creating music right now, keeping
that.
It simple. And you know, I lived down in Florida, and so I'm not in the Music City anymore where you could just call on any musician. So I went down to the local music store, and a couple of kids, one of the kids works there, he's 22-year-old,
really?
Chet Atkins freak, and he comes around, and then a little African-American kid comes by, he's just a monster piano player, and I'm on drums, and the three of us are just jamming till 2 in the morning in a room in my house with no sound system or anything, just, you know, just enjoying.
Right.
It doesn't have to be a big deal, you know. So just
thinking about the On Fire record, mm-hmm. as you know, as I've listened to it, why not do a stripped down acoustic guitar Peter Furler rather than 20 58 63 tracks or everybody's
yes.
on, you know what I mean, because it is
totally.
it's not what we're talking
it's
about right
totally
now
totally not what. And I think the reason why is because when I first when I finished up with the Newsboys, I didn't know what I was going to do.
Yeah.
And so when I went back to doing music, I went back to doing it how I've always done it. Mm-hmm. I actually went and bought, I probably spent, I think it was close to $30,000 just on stuff that I had with the new, you know, in-ear mm-hmm. monitors and
yep.
wireless microphones and guitar wireless packs and all this stuff. Right. And I bought it all. And I probably used it, I don't know, 10 times. And then even when I was on Winter Jam, which I was on as early as the beginning of this year, 2012, I even went on that. And it wasn't until the end of that that I realized, what are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
You're just going, you're doing it exactly how you've always done it. And that's, you know, this time is a new wineskin. And so, and I think it's only just been now. I mean, so it will affect the next record where you're dead right. You know, this last record, although I'm happy with it and, you know, I don't have any regrets, I won't be making that record again. You know, not this next time around. Hey, I could
right.
later on, but right now I don't see it ever happening.
But maybe it's just a great bridge, right? From that Newsboys stratosphere, if you will, to
yeah,
wherever Peter Furler is.
Wherever I'm going.
Yeah, to wherever it is, right?
Yeah, that's right.
But it's sort of, everything's a bridge,
what,
I know.
Yeah, what
yeah.
comes to, it's right. And what comes to my mind is what Peter Frampton said, you know, there are different types of people, but there's, you know, there are some people who are pop stars and they get their 18 months, and I want to be a musician, you know, and that's for life. And so that's what it is for me. It's not, you know, I've had full respect for guys like Phil Keaggy,
mm-hmm.
you know, Mike Rowe, guys that are still out there doing it, playing, you know, churches or playing anywhere they can just for the love of it. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's, you know, I sort of just, I dig it. And if, you know, if something great happens, great. But I don't, you know, I just want to make it, my next record, I just want to make it great. But it's got to be, again, it's got to be traveling light, you know.
I thought Peter Frampton said, wow, 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 no.
Yeah.
What is that song that was on
Frampton? Do You Feel.
Yeah, yeah, Do You Feel. Yeah, the one that's like a 17-minute jam or
that's
something, right?
Right? Yeah, yeah. But that's when you used to be out of jam, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, but just seeing that dude's career sort of ebb and flow, and now he probably plays more shows a year for the love of music.
It is, and it's really, and I think that was a big thing for me. I think of guys like, and I do not compare myself to any of these guys, but I do know that there are guys like Peter Gabriel was somebody that, you know, 7 years after he's with Genesis, I think he comes out with his first solo record and doesn't do nothing. And then 3 or 4 years later, which is 10 years after Genesis, he comes out with So.
Right.
You know, it's like, and then after that, whatever, had Sledgehammer. It's like, so we're talking, he just, and guys like that still in it. And you know what? And Paul McCartney's another one. You know, they, guys like that, we don't remember now, but man, they disappeared for decades.
Sure.
And no, you know what I mean? But they just stuck with it for the love of music. And I think that's what you got to be in it for. It's not about, if you're in it for success or the cash, you will always be disappointed in some way.
Yeah, and just talking about Peter Gabriel, I mean, I think he's, I, to me, he's more creative now.
Yeah.
And not only with his music, but also with his life and doing a lot of, you know, social justice work and
that's
stuff.
Right,
and I just go, wow, maybe he had to find himself. Maybe you find yourself when you're, quote unquote, publicly lost. You know what I mean?
I think so. I think you do, because before that, everyone's telling you who you are.
Sure.
You
know? And it's easy to believe that stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Of course it is, yeah.
Yeah. You're the man. So you feel more alive, if I can segue into a song on the record, but yeah, turning your life around toward aliveness.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like I'm a free spirit, you know, and in every way there was lots of things, you know, free from, you know, your own thoughts and your own crazy ideas that you have, and part of youth. It's a great time in life where, you know, your Lord willing, your wisdom starts to catch up with your energy. You know, it's a good time in life.
Yeah, and I thought it was an interesting line saying, you know, I chased one more mirage.
Yeah,
because there, the one more mirage, after I get to that mirage and find out, like you said, it isn't all it's cracked up to be.
That's right.
I still want to believe the next mirage is.
That's right. Yeah.
The next nirvana or something.
That's right. And part of it is you have to kind of have that hope, but sometimes all what you are chasing is a mirage, but the drive is not always bad, but unless you're just chasing the wrong thing, that's when it's it's waste.
Yeah, and it's funny. Lately, I've been talking about having drive and also letting life be.
Yeah.
And where is that balance, right? Because you do want to drive and find out what else is out there, but then you miss what's going on here.
Yeah, that's a big thing. I think you can get your mind just send you in all these places that you know, where really what's happening is here and now can be a great thing.
Yeah. Reach, you're a God guy, obviously. God's always there, reaching out for us.
I think it's that, and you know, he cares about us a lot more than we do, you know. Mm. And he cares about, you know, where, you know, he really does, you know, he has a love for us that we can't imagine most of the time. But it's no matter what, where you've been, what you've done, what you've been up to, what situation you got going on in life. You know, the Bible says that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so I think...
I don't know. I've done pretty well at sometimes feeling like there's no God there just because I'm pissed about something, right?
That's right, yeah. And again, you know, I've found in my life I can't trust my feelings because they're always... They're all over the place sometimes. They're emotions, but he's the same. And yeah, I do believe that. I believe that he's a God of love. I don't believe he makes anybody sick or takes anybody up to heaven with him. He's a God. He's the author of life, you know, and there's no sickness in heaven for him to give us.
Right. You know, I was thinking just when I said that, I interviewed Peter Garrett from Midnight Oil.
Oh, great, yeah.
Way back in the day, and I loved him. He's such a gentle soul and for such a big presence, right?
Yes.
And I assume that's why you shave your head, but that's a whole other story. But you know that Midnight Oil hand logo thing?
Yeah,
I've always been intrigued by it because is it somebody reaching out for help or is it somebody reaching out to help you?
Right.
And I always, every time I hear the word reach, I kind of go, yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I can't define it, and maybe that's what makes it so awesome.
That's right. That's exactly right.
You know, I need a Midnight Oil shirt with just the hand on it.
Yeah.
Can you give me one next time you go home?
That was a big seller, that one. That was the shirt, you know. That one on Peter Garrett's head with the...
Well, with the
sunglasses, yeah.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, right. Well, now he's in government down there, right?
Yeah, member of parliament. He's been in that for a while now.
Yeah. Was he one of the guys you looked up to when you were a kid?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. You know, the Australian music scene during the '80s was just, you know, I mean, obviously I was an Aussie kid, but it was like, you know, you go down the road to the local pub and you could see Midnight Oil, NXS, Hoodoo Gurus, Housing Collectors. Yeah. The list goes on, you know. So every band was touring and playing, and they had to. So
it was all
about the live show. You know, it wasn't. They didn't have big video clips to make them famous or big record deals, even. You know, because you had a gold record in Australia at the time. I think was 20,000 or 30,000 copies.
Yeah, right.
So
right,
wasn't, you know.
I would love to get all y'all, if you will, into a room and wonder where everybody is on their path of living with less or living lighter.
Yeah.
I wonder where they're all at because, you know, I mean, obviously what Michael Hutchins,
yes,
you know,
yeah,
couldn't take the world anymore for some reason.
Yeah, that's right.
You know? Did you like NXS?
Yeah, I grew, you know, they were another band that had some big hits.
Yeah.
The Models were a great band.
Mm.
Gosh, there was tons of great.
Yeah, and you know the band that I'm into right now is Carnivool. Pretty heavy guy, pretty heavy sound, but his lyrics are just, oh man, they just grab me. Again, one of those things,
right.
I'm really not into the music, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, where I can hear Gautier and kind of go, oh, I understand.
Right, yeah.
You know, but I really actually like the other tracks on those records too. So how about All In Your Head? Is that part of your journey that you were...
Yeah, you know, you know, I think we all go through, you know, in your youth, you fill your head with all this knowledge, you know, if, you know, you try and read what everyone else is reading or read above your own grade. And then at some point, it can also go flat, you know, where you just, I don't know, you know, but yeah, that's just a track about, you know, I guess to simplify, it's just putting, you know, stop talking about it, go and do it, you know.
Yeah.
Stop thinking about it, get out there and live it, you know.
Well, and I think that's the hardest thing for me is, right, as I'm watching Seinfeld and going, man, I should really get out and bike or run or play with my kids.
Right.
And then finally get to another episode of Seinfeld coming on, right?
Yeah.
And I just wonder, what is that? What is that thing that is inside of us that goes, click, yep, get up, go do?
Yeah.
You know?
I think you get tired of yourself.
Wow,
you just get sick of yourself, you know, and you have to come to the end of yourself.
Yeah.
I think for me, I'm somebody that, you know, if I look at a cookbook, I'll put on weight. You know, if I'm just somebody that I love food. And so, but that's something that's a struggle for me to, and I figured, like, people talk about, well, how do you lose weight? What do you do this and what do you do that? Well, the key is, there's not really any diet. It's really a decision that you hate yourself being this way more than you love that food. And so that's how I try to, I have to keep, you know, and I nearly have to tell myself, you're going to put that in your body, you're going to do this. And that's the tough one. And you know what else I've really felt is, as I've gotten older, you know, I guess this is still to do with the subject, but as I've gotten older, it's like you know, it's people, they say, well, your metabolism slows down and you blah, blah, blah. And you know, hey, I'm not sure I buy all that stuff. You know, for me, I just realized when I was 10 years old as a kid, you look at your kids, they run around like maniacs everywhere. They're just burning calories all day. And they can, of course, they can eat what they want.
Right.
When we get older, we don't run around like kids anymore.
Right.
And so, but I do think in life, for me, you know, when you're saying, how do you, I got to come to the end of myself and go, I got to keep moving. I got to get out there and keep doing it. I can't settle.
Yeah,
and do whatever it takes to. It's not about just losing weight; it's just your life, just getting out there and going for it. Because I feel so terrible when I'm sitting, even just getting up off on the couch and carrying 10 extra pounds. It just drives me nuts. You know?
Well, you know, it's weird for me because when I was waiting to throw on the recorder, right? I'm at catering, and there's some carrots and broccoli and stuff. I grabbed a cookie.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know if that's that internal, you know, now I'm in psychobabble land, right? But it's like, is it that internal, you deserve the cookie? Yet I know right after I ate it, I went, I didn't need that.
Yeah, and I'm the same. I think...
It's so weird.
You know what else I've really learned is whenever, whatever you eat, that's what you desire. And so at some point, you just have to make a transition to... Like now when I try and grab fruit, you know, I try and, you know, eat that. And then that's what I feel like. And I don't even feel like a cookie. And But I'm normally someone that would eat snacks and whatever. My wife really was the same with water. She didn't feel like she was drinking much water. She'd just drink soda and whatever.
Yeah, sure.
And I said, well, here, just do this as an experiment just for one day.
Mm-hmm.
Take these, you know, 6 waters. Just drink them all in one day. That's all you got to do, drink them all. And what happens is, drinking water makes you thirsty. you just start to desire water, and then, and then Coke or whatever can't fill it. Even though I love to have a Coke every now and then, it's not—it's not what I run to now. I need water, you know. So you just have to. I don't know. It's like you train yourself. People that say I don't like salads is because you don't eat them. You got to eat them, start eating them, and just get over the hump, you know.
Yeah, I it's probably like the getting on that bike too, right? It's the, I mean, the bike of living lighter.
Yeah.
You know, of once you. Once you know that you're actually satisfied and you actually feel better,
yes,
this is a good thing.
That's right. The reward's way longer. It lasts a lot longer than the cookie does.
Yeah, because you know, carrying around less weight or less clothes.
Yes,
these are all good things.
That's right. It's a lot, and sometimes you know you can't do it, and you can't do it all at once because it didn't happen at once.
Right.
It happened just a day at a time, a pound at a time, whatever it is. That's how it works, you know.
Right, but me being an American, you being an Australian, I think we should have it. Right now.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so I want it here and now. Yeah,
right now. So maybe that's what you're going into in Matter of Faith, where you just want to start and start anew, start it over. And
I think that was really just thinking about who Jesus is and what he did and his power. You know, to me, it was when I read the scriptures and it talks about things being made right and no more tears I know our life as a Christian, my life isn't about just heaven or hell and waiting around until something happens, until I die, and if I was a good boy I'd go and float on some clouds. That's not my idea of heaven, and I'm pretty sure it's not God's idea either.
Right.
I think what he started in the beginning he plans on finishing, and so it's a productive, it's a productive thing, a creative thing. And so for me, it was just a longing for that time when things would be made right, there'd be justice in the world. And, but that is faith. That's a matter of faith. It's not science. It's too powerful for science, you know. And that's what it is. It's what I believe. And
but is the same? Do we have the same problem of getting up off the couch and wiping off the tear of our neighbor, and we're sort of waiting for Jesus to do it because Seinfeld's on?
Devin, that's a good point. Yeah, you know, it's something that it's hard. It's always hard.
I know, right?
It's very hard to not just get off the couch, but we can get really, jaded really easy.
Sure.
You go, wow, that dude got himself in that position because he's a goofball, you know what I mean? And so, so it does.
He keeps eating cookies.
Yeah, he's eating cookies. He deserves it. Yeah.
Exactly, right?
But yeah, it is, it's something that, there are lots of opportunities all the time just to share a kind word and to take it to another level with people.
So you have songs that are really praisey, right? Really
praising
God.
Yeah.
But is that the guy you are, or do those songs work in a concert setting? And do they help me ride my bike better and faster and make me feel closer to God? Or is that just who you are, too? I mean, because I'm not that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Until the song comes on my iPod and I kind of go, wow, this dude is really giving it up for God.
Right, yeah.
You know, so I wonder, sometimes I always wonder why people write those songs.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think I don't know why other people write them. I think for me, it's part of my job. Mm. I think in the Bible, I see people have different roles. They're obviously there's evangelist type guys that just have this, they can be a little annoying sometimes, to say the least. But there's a gift there, and we all have certain gifts. Some guys are encouragers. The Bible talks about the gift of encouragement. There are some that are really administrative. Just know, well, like I couldn't probably, I might lose two shirts unless I got a guy that reminds me, hey, did you get your shirts? And so we all need each other in that way. But I did realize, I think I really came, growing up as a Christian and in the 80s and 90s, as a Christian band, you were nearly expected to do it all.
Right.
You're going to be the evangelist and you're going to be this and this and whatever.
Right.
But I don't think I'm an evangelist, and I don't think I'm a teacher. And so I've realized, but I do know one thing, I'm a songwriter and I'm a musician. And so part of my job as a Christian one is to lead a congregation or lead a group, give them something to sing, because so that's sort of how I see it. And obviously as a believer, I want to write something that tickles God's ears, I guess, and so it gives him pleasure, and but yeah, I see it as my job. It's part of my job.
Yeah, And so when you talk to your dad about the songs that you're performing, does he go, I love the praise ones more than he likes the ones that are quirky and diving into other subject matter? Or where is he at it?
I think he probably likes the praise stuff.
Yeah, okay,
more.
That's the kind of guy he is.
You know, but he'd like both.
Because he's a pastor, right?
Yes,
yeah,
that's
okay.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Because I love the song you did with Steve Taylor, right? Closer, where it's where the world is so messed up, and you're examining your whole life kind of in that
song,
right?
Yep.
Is that how you took it too?
Yeah, that one's just like, you know, there's a bigger picture going on.
Yep.
You know, there's more to this life than just you and yourself and your own thoughts. Have a look at what's going on and be a part of the revolution that's coming, you know, that makes the place better, not worse, you know.
Mm.
It's also not, you know, we're not hanging on just for a rapture,
yeah.
You know, I mean, or some crazy idea. It's like we're here as a body, as a group of people that are meant to do what Jesus said and follow his, you know, his ideas and with his power do that and make the world better. You know?
And did Steve write the lyrics to that song particularly?
Yes, a good chunk of them, yeah. All the good ones.
All the good ones.
As usual.
Because I don't ever think of him as writing a praise song, right? Though
he would, well, he
but, we, but the we, way he writes it, that sort of cleverly way that
yes.
it maybe can work that way for.
Well, we wrote He Reigns together.
Hmm.
So that was, and he was a vital part of that. Yeah, so, and we've had moments, we've done a few, but yeah, it hasn't been something that he's, I think he was scared to death when we first started talking about it.
Yeah.
Back in the day, so.
Yeah. How about Faster and Louder, which I guess, I think it's a great song right after it lyrically, because you're kind of dealing with
the apathy. Yeah, it's what we're talking about. It's like, don't die yet, you know, don't die yet. It's not, you know, we got some living to do.
Yeah, and if you've been mellowed out, I know the cure.
That's right.
Nice. I'm just going to say I'm dovetailing Hold On in that, right? That life's a battle and you got to fight for it.
Yeah, that's right. It's self-explanatory. That one's just, you know, a song of encouragement. Again, you know, people sometimes, you know, you get so fired up about something or your thoughts are so powerful, man. You know, it's like you have to really be careful what you think. And I'm not talking Tony Robbins stuff or whoever them guys are. I'm just talking a biblical thing of, you know, important being careful and renewing your mind, you know, all the time. Because, man, we can head into a funk really quickly. Most people can. They can just head into this dive of loneliness and, you know, self-depreciation, all these things. And I've been in it and I had to think my way out of it, you know.
So in your living lighter world, which I keep going back to, right?
Yeah.
I keep cornering you on that, right?
Because
I'm
right.
So intrigued by it. But in that world, does that mean you actually carry less weight of the world around with you?
You definitely do, yeah, because you get to...
Even your mind is,
yes, totally.
Lighter.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah. I'm, I guess, free spirit's the term. You know, it's not that I don't have worries, but I just sort of know what to do with them. Now when they come, I put them in certain places. Obviously, there's something I can't, if it's out of my control, I just you know, hand it over to someone higher than me. And
but I would say you would have said that in an interview 10 or 15 years ago too, right?
Yeah, but, I probably would have some of them, but there would have been other stuff like, you know, the other type cares of business or business or career, even, you know, that can be. You and I could have been having this interview 10 years ago on a Love Liberty Disco tour, and I might have been $800,000 in debt.
Right.
So I'm thinking about that a bit harder than, you know, so it does.
So does it help you connect with God better or quicker? You know, I'm thinking in the lyrics of that song, looking up and praying for some hope tonight, just to feel alive.
Right.
Because if you're thinking about $800,000 in debt.
Yeah.
You're trying to go, okay, God, how do I connect with you? But now maybe, can you connect in a...
It works both ways. Because sometimes them painful things are the things that really draw you close when you realize that you have nothing else.
Right. And I got to ask you about motorcycles because...
I like that.
Are you a helmet guy?
I definitely. Yeah,
definitely
a
helmet guy?
I always say that anytime you see someone ride around without a helmet... That's just someone who hasn't crashed yet.
Yeah.
That's about it. So I see kind of why people want to do it, but not me. I've ridden dirt bikes all my life and crashed them like a maniac.
Yeah.
And, you know, picked myself off the ground, dusted off, and looked, and there's a hole the size of a, you know, size of a fist in your helmet. I'm
right.
Like, yeah, I would have just been dead then.
Yeah, right.
So I've had enough times like that where I've had to throw away a helmet or...
Oh, wow.
It's like, so...
So how fast have you gone?
I've done about 130.
Yeah.
In Baja, Mexico.
That's hauling, dude.
Yeah, it was.
You've been that fast in Nashville. You're not.
Well, in a car, I did. Yeah, but.
Oh, really? Yeah, oh, okay.
I didn't do it on. I don't think I've. I've probably done 120 in Nashville, but maybe 130. But it's usually the Baja's an easier place to do it, and I can remember going as fast enough to where my eyeballs were shaking in their sockets, and I couldn't get any depth of field or know.
Oh,
when
really?
I seen, I thought it's time to slow down now. I think the bike could have kept going.
Yeah, the G forces are just sucking your eyeballs.
Something
your
was
head.
Going on. It was like just this weird vibration where I couldn't focus no matter what. So.
Wow.
But I don't make that a habit.
Yeah, well.
You can't show this interview to my wife now.
Yeah, well, I'm just bicycling, right? So I'm on two wheels, and it isn't the same, obviously, as being on a motorcycle, but. All of a sudden, I get up over 40 miles an hour now. I'm starting to get scared.
Yeah, that's
and I don't
fast
know if that's an age thing or if it's... I've crashed a couple of times, right? And I actually absolutely believe a helmet saved my life. But I just wonder, later on, do we go, you know, I don't need that.
Right, yeah.
You know, maybe that's living lighter too, right?
You mean the
I don't
helmet?
Need, no, I don't know. I don't need speed to feel alive.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, not that plenty of people don't.
Yeah, and I'm not... Even now, I would consider... I'd probably definitely drive my car slower than I ever have. And I think partly too, it's not that I don't need speed, I'm just not in a rush now.
Yeah.
You know, before I was always in a rush going,
yeah, sure.
Whatever, and so now I just go, you know, just try and, you know, what are you in a rush for? And so, and on motorbike, I would say I'm fairly conservative too now these days.
Peter, I appreciate the time, dude.
Thanks, mate. Appreciate
really
your time.
Very nice.
Time.
Very nice. So very pleased that you chose this long-form interview in which to listen in. Peter's the type of person who uses words born out of the center of his chest. One more reason I respect this man from down under. Thank you. Thank you for reals. I know you're searching. Don't stop.
Don't.
Keep on scouring lyrics and songs and movies and books and
anywhere
you can find inspiration. Because, and I know I'm still wrestling with this, you are worthy of love and a great life. Give and get. Listen in and share the goodness. I sign off sincerely, Frank Jenks, questioner, interviewer, searcher, hoper.